Bastarnae. The Bastarnae, Latin variants, Bastarnae, or Bastarnae, were an ancient people who between 200 BC and 300 AD inhabited the region between the Carpathian Mountains and the river Dnieper, to the north and east of ancient Dacia. The Pusani, denoted a branch of the Bastarnae by Greco-Roman writers, occupied the region north of the Danube Delta. The ethno-linguistic affiliation of the Bastarnae was probably Celtic, which is supported by earliest historians. However, later historian sources imply a Germanic or Scytho-Sarmatian origins. Often they are associated with the Germans, or the peoples between the Celts and the Germans. The most likely scenario is that they were originally a Celtic tribe, originally resident in the lower Vistula River Valley. In ca. 200 BC, these tribes then migrated, possibly accompanied by some Germanic elements, southeastwards into the North Pontic region. Some elements appear to have become assimilated, to some extent, by the surrounding Sarmatians by the 3rd century. Although largely sedentary, some elements may have adopted a semi-nomadic lifestyle. It has not, so far, been possible to identify archaeological sites which can be conclusively attributed to the Bastarnae. The archaeological horizons most often associated by scholars with the Bastarnae are the Zarubintsi and Poyanesht-Lukasheva cultures. The Bastarnae first came into conflict with the Romans during the 1st century BC, when, in alliance with Dacians and Sarmatians, they unsuccessfully resisted Roman expansion into Moesia and Pannonia. Later, they appeared to have maintained friendly relations with the Roman Empire during the first 2 centuries AD. This changed from circa 180, when the Bastarnae are recorded as participants in an invasion of Roman territory, once again in alliance with Sarmatian and Dacian elements. In the mid-3rd century, the Bastarnae were part of a Gothic-led grand coalition of Lower Danube tribes that repeatedly invaded the Balkan provinces of the Roman Empire. Large numbers of Bastarnae were resettled within the Roman Empire in the late 3rd century. According to Polybius, 200-118 BC, a mission from the Dardanians now arrived, telling of the Bastarnae, their numbers, the huge size and the valor of their warriors, and also pointing out that Perseus and the Galatians were in league with this tribe. They said they were much more afraid of him than of the Bastarnae, and they begged for aid. According to Livy, 64 BC-17 AD, the way to the Hadriatic and to Italy lay through the Scordisci. That was the only practicable route for an army, and the Scordisci were expected to grant a passage to the Bastarnae without any difficulty, for neither in speech nor habits were they dissimilar, and it was hoped that they would unite forces with them when they saw that they were going to secure the plunder of a very wealthy nation. According to Strabo, 64 BC-24 AD. However, it is clear from the climata and the parallel distances that if one travels longitudinally towards the east, one encounters the regions that are about the Borysthenes and that are to the north of the Pontus, but what is beyond Germany and what beyond the countries which are next after Germany, whether one should say the Bastarnae, as most writers suspect, or say that others lying between, either the Iusages, or the Roxolani, or certain other of the Wagon dwellers, it is not easy to say, nor yet whether they extend as far as the ocean along its entire length, or whether any part is uninhabitable by reason of the cold or other cause, or whether even a different race of people, succeeding the Germans, is situated between the sea and the eastern Germans. And this same ignorance prevails also in regard to the rest of the peoples that come next in order on the north, for I know neither the Bastarnae, nor the Sauromatae, nor, in a word, any of the peoples who dwell above the Pontus, nor how far distant they are from the Atlantic Sea, nor whether their countries border upon it. According to Plutarch, AD 46-120 AD, he also secretly stirred up the Gauls settled along the Danube, who are called Bastarnae, an equestrian host and warlike, and he invited the Illyrians, through Genthius their king, to take part with him in the war. And a report prevailed that the barbarians had been hired by him to pass through Lower Gaul, along the coast of the Adriatic, and make an incursion into Italy. According to Tacitus, 56-120 AD, as to the tribes of the Pusani, Veneti, and Feni, I am in doubt whether I should class them with the Germans or the Sarmate, although indeed the Pusani, called by some Bastarn, are like Germans in their language, mode of life, and in the permanence of their settlements. They all live in filth and sloth, and by the intermarriages of the chiefs they are becoming in some degree debased into a resemblance to the Sarmate. According to Cassius Dio, 155-235 AD, During the same period in which these events occurred, Marcus Crassus was sent into Macedonia and Greece and carried on war with the Dacians and Bastarnae. I have already stated who the former were and why they had become hostile. The Bastarnae, on the other hand, who are properly classed as Scythians, had at this time crossed the Ister and subdued the part of Mysia opposite them, and afterwards subdued the Triballi who adjoin this district and the Dardani who inhabit the Triballian country. According to Sosismus, 490s, 510 AD. He likewise left in Thrace the Bastarnae, a Scythian people, who submitted to him, giving them land to inhabit there, on which account they observed the Roman laws and customs. The origin of the tribal name is uncertain. It is not even clear whether it was an exonym, a name ascribed to them by outsiders, or an endonym, a name by which the Bastarnae described themselves. A related question is whether the groups denoted Bastarnae by the Romans considered themselves a distinct ethnic group at all, endonym, or whether it was a generic exonym used by the Greco-Romans to denote a disparate group of tribes of the Carpathian region that could not be classified as Dacians or Sarmatians. One possible derivation is from the Proto-Germanic word bastion, from Proto-Indo-European root bis, means binding or tie. In this case, Bastarnae may have had the original meaning of a coalition or bond of tribes. It is possible that the Roman term basterna, denoting a type of wagon or litter, is derived from the name of this people, or, if it is an exonym, the name of the people is derived from it, which was known, like many Germanic tribes, to travel with a wagon train for their families. It has also been suggested that the name is linked with the Germanic word bastard, meaning illegitimate or mongrel. But Batty considers this derivation unlikely. If the name is an endonym, then this derivation is unlikely, as most endonyms have flattering meanings, for example brave, strong, noble. Trubisev proposes a derivation from Old Persian, avestan bast bound, tied, slave, cf. Ascetic beton bind, bast bound, and Iranian arna offspring, equating it with the delta omicron upsilon lambda sigma pi omicron rho omicron iota slave Sparoi mentioned by Nonnus and Cosmas, where Sparoi is the people Procopius mentions as the ancestors of Slavs. The original homeland of the Bastarnae remains uncertain. Babes and Shchukin argue in favor of an origin in eastern Pomerania on the Baltic coast of NW Poland, on the grounds of correspondences in archaeological material, for example a Pomeranian-style fibula found in a Poianesht site in Moldavia, although Batty considers the evidence insufficient. Babes identifies the Sidoni, a branch of the Bastarnae which Strabo places north of the Danube Delta with the Sidini located by Ptolemy in Pomerania. Batty argues that Greco-Roman sources of the 1st century AD locate the Bastarnae homeland on the northern side of the northern Carpathian mountain range, encompassing SE Poland and SW Ukraine, i.e. the region traditionally known as Galicia. Pliny locates the Bastarnae between the Suebi and the Dacians, contermini Daci. The Peutinger map, produced in ca. 400 AD, but including material from as early as the 1st century, shows the Bastarnae, misspelt Blastarni, north of the Carpathian Mountains and appears to name the Galician Carpathians as the Al-Bastarnicae. From Galicia, the Bastarnae expanded into modern-day Moldavia and Bessarabia, reaching the Danube Delta. Strabo describes the Bastarnae as inhabiting the territory between the Ister, River Danube, and the Borysthenes, River Dnieper. He identifies three sub-tribes of the Bastarnae, the Atmoni, Sidoni, and Pusani. The latter derived their name from Pius, a large island in the Danube Delta, which they had colonized. The 2nd century geographer Ptolemy states that the Carpiani or Carpi, believed to have occupied Moldavia, separated the Pusani from the other Bastarnae above Dacia, i.e. north of Dacia. It thus appears that the Bastarnae were settled in a vast arc stretching around the northern and eastern flanks of the Carpathians from SE Poland to the Danube Delta. The larger group inhabited the northern and eastern slopes of the Carpathians and the region between the Prut and Dnieper rivers, Moldova Republic/Western Ukraine, while a separate group, the Pusani, Sidonian Atmoni, dwelt in and north of the Danube Delta region. Scholars hold divergent theories about the ethnicity of the Bastarnae. The view, following what appears to be the most authoritative view among earliest scholars, is that they spoke Celtic. However, others hold that they were Scythian/Germanic, or mixed Germanic/Sarmatian. A fringe theory is that they were Proto-Slavic. Shchukin argues that ethnicity of the Bastarnae was unique, and rather than trying to label the Bastarnae as Celtic, Germanic or Sarmatian, it should be accepted that the Bastarnae were the Bastarnae. Batty argues that assigning an ethnicity to the Bastarni is meaningless, as in the context of the Iron Age Pontic Danubian region, with its multiple overlapping peoples and languages, ethnicity was a very fluid concept. It could and did change rapidly and frequently, according to socio-political vicissitudes. This was especially true of the Bastarni, who are attested over a relatively vast area. A leading reason to consider the Bastarni as Celtic is that the regions they are documented to have occupied, northern and eastern slopes of the Carpathians, overlap to a great extent with the locations of Celtic tribes attested in the northern Carpathians. Indeed, a large part of this region, Galicia, may derive its name from its former Celtic inhabitants, the Taurisci, Ossi, Catini and Anarts of Slovakia and northern Romania and the Britigalli of the Danubian mouth region. In addition, archaeological cultures, which some scholars have linked to the Bastarni, Poianesht Lukashivka Asnd Zarubansi, display pronounced Celtic affinities. Finally, the arrival of the Bastarni in the Pontic Danubian region, which can be dated to 233 to 216 BC according to two ancient sources, coincides with the latter phase of Celtic migration into the region, 400 to 200 BC. The earliest historians give a Celtic or Gallic origin to the Bastarni. Roman historian Livy, writing in circa AD 10, attests that the Bastarni spoke Celtic. Relating the Bastarnic invasion of the Balkans of 179 BC, see conflict with Rome below, he describes them then as they were not very different in either language or manners to the Celtic tribe of the Scordisci, a tribe of Pannonia. The Scordisci are described as Celtic by Strabo, although he adds that they had mingled with Illyrians and Thracians. The Greeks historian Plutarch informs us that the Roman consul Hostilius secretly stirred up the Gauls settled along Danube, who are called Bastarni. However, a Celtic identity for the Bastarni is apparently contradicted by Polybius, writing ca. 150 BC, who was an actual contemporary of the events described, unlike Livy, who was writing some 200 years later. Polybius clearly distinguishes the Bastarni from the Galati, i.e. Celts. An embassy from the Dardani arrived at the Roman Senate, talking of the Bastarni, their huge numbers, the strength and valor of their warriors, and also reporting that Perseus, king of Macedon, and the Galati were in league with this tribe. In addition, inscription A, 1905:14, recording a campaign on the Hungarian plain by the Augusti era general Marcus Vinutius, 10 BC or 8 BC, also appears to distinguish the Bastarni from neighboring Celtic tribes. Marcus Vinutius, governor of Illyricum, the first Roman general to advance across the river Danube, defeated in battle and routed an army of Dacians and Bastarni, and subjugated the Catini, Ossi, missing tribal name, and Anarti to the power of the Emperor Augustus and of the people of Rome. The names of three Bastarni leaders are preserved in the ancient sources are of Celtic origin, Codo, Clondicus, and Teutogonus. Greco-Roman geographers of the 1st century AD are unanimous and specific that the Bastarni were Germanic in language and culture. The Greek geographer Strabo, writing circa AD 5-20, says the Bastarni are of Germanic stock. The Roman geographer Pliny the Elder, circa AD 77, classifies the Bastarni and Cusani as constituting one of the five main subdivisions of Germanic peoples. He lists the other subdivisions as the Inguiones, Istiones and Hermiones, West Germanic tribes, and the Vandili, Vandals, East Germanic, but he classifies differently than the Bastarni. The Roman historian Tacitus, circa AD 100, describes the Bastini as Germans with substantial Sarmatian influence, but moves on to state, the Pusani, however, who are sometimes called Bastarni, are like the Germans in their language, way of life and types of dwelling. Strabo includes the Roxolani, generally considered by scholars to have been a Sarmatian tribe, in a list of Bastarni subgroups. However, this may simply be an error due to the close proximity of the two peoples north of the Danube Delta. In the 3rd century, the Greek historian Dio Cassius states that the Bastarni are properly classed as Scythians and members of the Scythian race. Likewise, the 6th century historian Zosimus, reporting events around AD 280, refers to the Bastarni, a Scythian people. However, it appears that these late Greco-Roman chroniclers used the term Scythian more often in a geographical sense, i.e. inhabitants of the region they called Scythia, i.e. the Pontic region north of the Danube, rather than in an ethnic one, i.e. members of the Scythian people, steppe nomads of Iranic origin, related to the Sarmatians, who had supplanted the Scythians' dominance of the steppes in the period BC. For example, Zosimus also routinely refers to the Goths, who were undoubtedly Germanic speakers, as Scythians. It is possible that some Bastarni may have been assimilated by the surrounding, and possibly dominant, Sarmatians, perhaps adopting their tongue, which belonged to the Iranian group of Indo-European languages, and or Sarmatian customs. Thus Tacitus' comment that mixed marriages are giving the Bastarni to some extent the vile appearance of the Sarmatians. On the other hand, the Bastarni maintained a separate name identity until ca. AD 300, probably implying retention of their distinctive ethno-linguistic heritage until that time. It seems, on balance, likely that the core population of Bastarni had always been, and continued to be, Germanic in language and culture. According to Todd, traditional archaeology has not been able to construct a typology of Bastarni material culture, and thus to ascribe particular archaeological sites to the Bastarni. A complicating factor is that the regions where Bastarni are attested contained a patchwork of peoples and cultures: Sarmatians, Scythians, Dacians, Thracians, Celts, Germans and others, some sedentary, some nomadic. In any event, post-1960s archaeological theory questions the validity of equating material cultures, as defined by archaeologists, with distinct ethnic groups. On this view, it is impossible to attribute a culture to a particular ethnic group. It is likely that the material cultures discerned in the region belonged to several, if not all, of the groups inhabiting it. These cultures probably represent relatively large-scale socio-economic interactions between disparate communities of the broad region, possibly including mutually antagonistic groups. It is not even certain whether the Bastarni were sedentary or nomadic, or semi-nomadic. Tacitus' statement that they were German in their way of life and types of dwelling implies a sedentary bias, but their close relations with the Sarmatians, who were nomadic, may indicate a more nomadic lifestyle for some Bastarni, as does the wide geographical range of their attested inhabitation. If the Bastarni were nomadic, then the sedentary cultures identified by archaeologists seeing their Lebensraum would not represent them. Nomadic peoples generally leave scant traces, due to the impermanent materials and foundations used in the construction of their dwellings. Scholars have identified two closely related sedentary cultures as possible candidates to represent the Bastarni, among other peoples, as their locations broadly correspond to where ancient sources place the Bastarni: the Zarubintsy culture lying in the forest steppe zone in northern Ukraine, southern Belarus, and the Poyanesht Lukashivka culture in northern Moldavia. These cultures were characterized by agriculture, documented by numerous fine sofsicles. Dwellings were either of surface or semi-subterranean types, with posts supporting the walls, a hearth in the middle, and large conical pits located nearby. Some sites were defended by ditches and banks, structures thought to have been built to defend against nomadic tribes from the steppe. Inhabitants practiced cremation. Cremated remains were either placed in large, handmade ceramic urns, or were placed in a large pit and surrounded by food and ornaments such as spiral bracelets and middle to late Latin type fibulae, attesting the continuing strength of Celtic influence in this region. A major problem with associating Lukashivka and Zarubintsy with the Bastarni is that both cultures had disappeared by the early 1st century AD, although the Bastarni continue to be attested in those regions throughout the Roman Principate. Another issue is that the Poyanesht Lukashivka culture has also been attributed to the Kostoboci, a people considered ethnic Dacian by mainstream scholarship, which inhabited northern Moldavia, according to Ptolemy, ca. AD 140. Indeed, Mircea Babes and Silvia Teodor, the two Romanian archaeologists who identified Lukashivka as Bastarnic, nevertheless insisted that the majority of the population in the Lukashivka sphere, and Moldavia, was Ghetto Dacian. A further problem is that neither of these cultures were present in the Danube Delta region, where a major concentration of Bastarni are attested by the ancient sources. Starting in about AD 200, the Chernyakhov culture became established in the Ukraine/Moldova region inhabited by the Bastarni. The culture is characterized by a high degree of sophistication in the production of metal and ceramic artifacts, as well as of uniformity over a vast area. Although this culture has conventionally been identified with the migration of the Gothic ethnos into the region from the northwest, Todd argues that its most important origin is Scytho-Sarmatian. Although the Goths certainly contributed to it, so probably did other peoples of the region such as the Dacians, Proto-Slavs, Carpi, and possibly the Bastarni. The Bastarni first appear in the historical record in 179 BC, when they crossed the Danube in massive force. They did so at the invitation of their long Timuli, King Philip V of Macedon, a direct descendant of Antigonus, one of the Diadochi, the generals of Alexander the Great who had shared out his empire after his death in 323 BC. The Macedonian king had suffered a disastrous defeat at the hands of the Romans in the Second Macedonian War, 200-197 BC, which had reduced him from a powerful Hellenistic monarch to the status of a petty client king with a much reduced territory and a tiny army. After nearly 20 years of slavish adherence to the Roman Senate's dictates, Philip had been goaded beyond endurance by the incessant and devastating raiding off the Dardani, a warlike Thraco-Illyrian tribe on his northern border, which his treaty-limited army was too small to counter effectively. Counting on the Bastarni, with whom he had forged friendly relations in earlier times, he plotted a strategy to deal with the Dardani and then to regain his lost territories in Greece and his political independence. First, he would unleash the Bastarni against the Dardani. After the latter had been crushed, Philip planned to settle Bastarni families in Dardania, southern Kosovo/Skopje region, to ensure that the region was permanently subdued. In the second phase, Philip aimed to launch the Bastarni on an invasion of Italy via the Adriatic coast. Although he was aware that the Bastarni were hardly likely to achieve the same success as Hannibal some 40 years earlier, and would most likely end up cut to pieces by the Romans, Philip hoped that the Romans would be distracted long enough to allow him to reoccupy his former possessions in Greece. But Philip, now 60 years of age, died before the Bastarni could arrive. The Bastarni host was still en route through Thrace, where it became embroiled in hostilities with the locals, who were unable, or unwilling, to provide them with sufficient food at affordable prices as they marched through. Probably in the vicinity of Philippopolis, modern Plovdiv, Bulgaria, the Bastarni broke out of their marching columns and pillaged the land far and wide. The terrified local Thracians took refuge with their families and animal herds on the slopes of Mons Danuka, the highest mountain in Thrace, Mount Musala, Ril Mts, Bulgaria. A large force of Bastarni chased them up the mountain, but were driven back and scattered by a massive hailstorm. Then the Thracians ambushed them, turning their descent into a panic-stricken rout. Back at their wagon lager in the plain, around half the demoralized Bastarni decided to return home, leaving circa 30,000 to press onto Macedonia. Philip's son and successor Perseus, while protesting his loyalty to Rome, deployed his Bastarni guests in winter quarters in a valley in Dardania, presumably as a prelude to a campaign against the Dardani the following summer. But in the depths of winter their camp was attacked by the Dardani. The Bastarni easily beat off the attackers, chased them back to their chief town, and besieged them. But they were surprised in the rear by a second force of Dardani, which had approached their camp stealthily by mountain paths, and proceeded to storm and ransack it. Having lost their entire baggage and supplies, the Bastarni were obliged to withdraw from Dardania and to return home. Most perished as they crossed the frozen Danube on foot, only for the ice to give way. Despite the failure of Philip's Bastarni strategy, the suspicion aroused by these events in the Roman Senate, which had been warned by the Dardani of the Bastarni invasion, ensured the demise of Macedonia as an independent state. Rome declared war on Perseus in 171 BC, and after the Macedonian army was crushed at the Battle of Pydna, 168 BC, Macedonia was split up into four Roman puppet cantons, 167 BC. 21 years later, these were in turn abolished and annexed to the Roman Republic as the province of Macedonia, 146 BC. The Bastarni first came into direct conflict with Rome as a result of expansion into the lower Danube region by the proconsuls, governors, of Macedonia in the period 75-72 BC. Gaius Scribonius Curio, proconsul 75-3 BC, campaigned successfully against the Dardani and the Mysi, becoming the first Roman general to reach the river Danube with his army. His successor, Marcus Licinius Lucullus, brother of the famous Lucius Lucullus, campaigned against the Thracian Bessa tribe in the Mysi, ravaging the whole of Moesia, the region between the Hemus, Balkan, mountain range in the Danube. In 72 BC, his troops occupied the Greek coastal cities of Scythia Minor, modern Dobruja region, Romania/Bulgaria, which had sided with Rome's Hellenistic archenemy, King Mithridates VI of Pontus, in the Third Mithridatic War, 73-63 BC. The presence of Roman forces in the Danube Delta was seen as a major threat by all the neighboring Transdanubian peoples, the Pusani Bastarni, the Sarmatians and, most importantly, by Burebista, ruled 82-44 BC, king of the Gedi. The Gedi occupied the region today called Wallachia as well as Scythia Minor and were either a Dacian or Thracian-speaking people. Bura Bista had unified the Chedi tribes into a single kingdom, for which the Greek cities were vital trade outlets. In addition, he had established his hegemony over neighboring Sarmatian and Bastarni tribes. At its peak, the Chedi kingdom reportedly was able to muster 200,000 warriors. Bura Bista led his Transdanubian coalition in a struggle against Roman encroachment, conducting many raids against Roman allies in Mysia and Thrace, penetrating as far as Macedonia and Illyria. The coalition's main chance came in 62 BC, when the Greek cities rebelled against Roman rule. In 61 BC, the notoriously oppressive and militarily incompetent proconsul of Macedonia, Gaius Antonius, nicknamed Hybrida, the monster, an uncle of the famous Mark Antony, led an army against the Greek cities. As his army approached Histria, Sinope, Antonius detached his entire mounted force from the marching column and led it away on a lengthy excursion, leaving his infantry without cavalry cover, a tactic he had already used with disastrous results against the Dardani. Dio implies that he did so out of cowardice, in order to avoid the imminent clash with the opposition. But it is more likely that he was pursuing a large enemy cavalry force, probably Sarmatians. A Bastarni host, which had crossed the Danube to assist the Histrians, promptly attacked, surrounded and massacred the Roman infantry, capturing several of their vexilla, military standards. This battle resulted in the collapse of the Roman position on the lower Danube. Bura Bista apparently annexed the Greek cities, 55 to 48 BC. At the same time, the subjugated allied tribes of Mysia and Thrace evidently repudiated their treaties with Rome, as they had to be reconquered by Augustus in 29 to 8 BC, see below. For 44 BC, Roman dictator for life Julius Caesar planned to lead a major campaign to crush Bura Bista and his allies once and for all, but he was assassinated before it could start. However, the campaign was made redundant by Bura Bista's overthrow on death in the same year, after which his Chedi empire fragmented into four, later five independent petty kingdoms. These were militarily far weaker, as Strabo assessed their combined military potential at just 40,000 armed men, and were often involved in internecine warfare. The Ghetto Dacians did not again become a threat to Roman hegemony in the lower Danube until the rise of Decebal 130 years later, AD 86. Once he had established himself as sole ruler of the Roman state in 30 BC, Caesar's grandnephew and adopted son Augustus inaugurated a strategy of advancing the empire's southeastern European border to the line of the Danube from the Alps, the Dinaric Alps and Macedonia. The primary objective was to increase strategic depth between the border and Italy and also to provide a major fluvial supply route between the Roman armies in the region. On the lower Danube, which was given priority over the upper Danube, this required the annexation of Mysia. The Romans' target were thus the tribes which inhabited Mysia, namely, from west to east, the Triballi, Mysi and those Chedi who dwelt south of the Danube. The Bastarni were also a target because they had recently subjugated the Triballi, whose territory lay on the southern bank of the Danube between the tributary rivers Utis, Veit, and Chebris, Sibritsa, with their chief town at Iscus, Gigan, Bulgaria. In addition, Augustus wanted to avenge the defeat of C. Antonius at Histria, Sinope, 32 years before Antor covered the lost military standards. These were held in a powerful fortress called Ginucla, Isaccea, near modern Tulcea, Romania, in the Danube Delta region, controlled by Xyraxes, the local Ghatan king. The man selected for the task was Marcus Licinius Crassus, grandson of Crassus the Triumvir and an experienced general at 33 years of age, who was appointed proconsul of Macedonia in 29 BC. The Bastarni provided the casus belli by crossing the Hemus and attacking the Denthalidi, a Thracian tribe who were Roman allies. Crassus marched to the Denthalidi's assistance, but the Bastarni host hastily withdrew over the Hemus at his approach. Crassus followed them closely into Mysia but they would not be drawn into battle, withdrawing beyond the Sibritsa. Crassus now turned his attention to the Mysi, his prime target. After a successful campaign which resulted in the submission of a substantial section of the Mysi, Crassus again sought out the Bastarni. Discovering their location from some peace envoys they had sent to him, he lured them into battle near the Sibritsa by a stratagem. Hiding his main body of troops in a wood, he stationed as bait a smaller vanguard in open ground before the wood. As expected, the Bastarni attacked the vanguard in force, only to find themselves entangled in the full-scale pitched battle with the Romans that they had tried to avoid. The Bastarni tried to retreat into the forest but were hampered by the wagon train carrying their women and children, as these could not move through the trees. Trapped into fighting to save their families, the Bastarni were routed. Crassus personally killed their king, Deldo, in combat, a feat which qualified him for Rome's highest military honor, spolia opima, but Augustus refused to award it on a technicality. Thousands of fleeing Bastarni perished, many asphyxiated in nearby woods by encircling fires set by the Romans, others drowned trying to swim across the Danube. Nevertheless, a substantial force dug themselves into a powerful hill fort. Crassus laid siege to fort, but had to enlist the assistance of Rolls, a Geton petty king, to dislodge them, for which service Rolls was granted the title of Socius et Amicus Populi Romani, ally and friend of the Roman people. The following year, 28 BC, Crassus marched on Geonucla. Petty King Xyraxes escaped with his treasure and fled over the Danube into Scythia to seek aid from Bastarni. But before he was able to bring reinforcements, Geonucla fell to a combined land and fluvial assault by the Romans. The strategic result of Crassus' campaigns was the permanent annexation of Moesia by Rome. About a decade later, in 10 BC, the Bastarni again clashed with Rome during Augustus' conquest of Pannonia, the Bellum Panonicum 14-9 BC. Inscription A, 1905, 14 records a campaign on the Hungarian plain by the Augusta-era general Marcus Vinutius, Marcus Vinutius. Patronymic, consul, in 19 BC, various official titles, governor of Illyricum, the first, Roman general, to advance across the river Danube, defeated in battle and routed an army of Dacians and Bastarni, and subjugated the Catini, Osi. Missing tribal name, and anarte to the power of the Emperor Augustus and of the people of Rome. Most likely, the Bastarni, in alliance with Dacians, were attempting to assist the hard-pressed Illyrian/Celtic tribes of Pannonia in their resistance to Rome. It appears that in the final years of Augustus' rule, the Bastarni made their peace with Rome. The Res Gestativi Augusti, Acts of the Divine Augustus AD 14, a self-congratulatory inscription commissioned by Augustus to list his achievements, states that he received an embassy from the Bastarni seeking a treaty of friendship. It appears that a treaty was concluded and apparently proved remarkably effective, as no hostilities with the Bastarni are recorded in surviving ancient sources until circa 175, some 160 years after Augustus' inscription was carved. But surviving evidence for the history of this period is so thin that it cannot be excluded that the Bastarni clashed with Rome during it. The Bastarni may have been involved in the Dacian Wars of Domitian, 86-88, and Trajan, 101-102 and 105-106, since these took place in the Lower Danube region and it is known that both sides were supported by neighboring indigenous tribes. In the late 2nd century, the Historia Augusta mentions that in the rule of Marcus Aurelius, 161-80, an alliance of Lower Danube tribes including the Bastarni, the Sarmatian Roxolani and the Costoboci took advantage of the emperor's difficulties on the Upper Danube, the Marcomannic Wars, to invade Roman territory. During the late 2nd century, the main ethnic change in the northern Black Sea region was the immigration, from the Vistula Valley in the north, of the Goths and accompanying Germanic tribes such as the Tafali and the Hastingi, a branch of the Vandal people. This migration was part of a series of major population movements in the European Barbaricum, the Roman term for regions outside their empire. The Goths appear to have established a loose political hegemony over the existing tribes in the region. Under the leadership of the Goths, a series of major invasions of the Roman Empire were launched by a grand coalition of Lower Danubian tribes from circa 238 onwards. The participation of the Bastarni in these is likely but largely unspecified, due to Zosimus and other chroniclers' tendency to lump all Thesi tribes under the general term Scythians, meaning all the inhabitants of Scythia, rather than the specific Iranic-speaking people called the Scythians. Thus, in 250-1, the Bastarni were probably involved in the Gothic and Sarmatian invasions which culminated in the Roman defeat at the Battle of Apretus and the slaying of the Emperor Decius, 251. This disaster was the start of the 3rd century crisis of the Roman Empire, a period of military and economic chaos. At this critical moment, the Roman army was crippled by the outbreak of a second smallpox pandemic, the Plague of Cyprian, 251-70. The effects are described by Zosimus as even worse than the earlier Antonine Plague, 166-80, which probably killed 15-30% of the empire's inhabitants. Taking advantage of Roman military disarray, a vast number of barbarian peoples overran much of the empire. The Sarmato-Gothic alliance of the Lower Danube carried out major invasions of the Balkans region in 252, and in the periods 253-8 and 262-8. The Pusani Bastarni are specifically mentioned in the 267-8 invasion, when the coalition built a fleet in the estuary of the river Tiris, Dnieper. The Pusani Bastarni would have been critical to this venture since, as coastal and delta dwellers, they would have had seafaring experience that the nomadic Sarmatians and Goths lacked. The barbarians sailed along the Black Sea coast to Thomas and Mysia Inferior, which they tried to take by assault without success. They then attacked the provincial capital Marcianopolis, Devnya, Vulg, also in vain. Sailing on through the Bosporus, the expedition laid siege to Thessalonica and Macedonia. Driven off by Roman forces, the coalition host moved overland into Thracia, where finally it was crushed by Emperor Claudius II, R.268-70, at Nisus, 269. Claudius II was the first of a sequence of military emperors, the so-called Illyrian emperors from their main ethnic origin, who restored order in the empire in the late 3rd century. These emperors followed a policy of large-scale resettlement within the empire of defeated barbarian tribes, granting them land in return for an obligation of military service much heavier than the usual conscription quota. The policy had the triple benefit, from the Roman point of view, of weakening the hostile tribe, repopulating the plague-ravaged frontier provinces, bringing their abandoned fields back into cultivation, and providing a pool of first-rate recruits for the army. But it could also be popular with the barbarian prisoners, who were often delighted by the prospect of a land grant within the empire. In the 4th century, such communities were known as Leti. The Emperor Probus, R. 276-82, is recorded as resettling 100,000 Bastarni in Mysia, in addition to other peoples, Goths, Gepids and Vandals. The Bastarni are reported to have honored their oath of allegiance to the emperor, while the other resettled peoples mutinied while Probus was distracted by usurpation attempts and ravaged the Danubian provinces far and wide. A further massive transfer of Bastarni was carried out by Emperor Diocletian, rule 284-305, after he and his colleague Galerius defeated a coalition of Bastarni and Carpi in 299. The remaining Transdanubian Bastarni disappear into historical obscurity in the late empire. Neither of the main ancient sources for this period, Aminus Marcellinus and Zosimus, mention the Bastarni in their accounts of the 4th century, possibly implying the loss of their separate identity, presumably assimilated by the regional hegemons, the Goths. Such assimilation would have been facilitated if, as is possible, the Bastarni spoke an East Germanic language closely related to Gothic. If the Bastarni remained an identifiable group, it is highly likely that they participated in the vast Gothic-led migration, driven by Hunnic pressure, that was admitted into Mysia by Emperor Valens in 376 and eventually defeated and killed Valens at Hadrianople in 378. Although Ammianus refers to the migrants collectively as Goths, he states that, in addition, Tafali and other tribes were involved. However, after a gap of 150 years, there is a final mention of Bastarni in the mid-5th century. In 451, the Hunnic leader Attila invaded Gaul with a large army which was ultimately routed at the Battle of Chalon by a Roman-led coalition under the general Aegeus. Attila's host, according to Jordanes, included contingents from the innumerable tribes that had been brought under his sway. One such were the Bastarni, according to the Gallic nobleman Sidonius Apollinaris. However, E.A. Thompson argues that Sidonius' mention of Bastarni at Chalon is probably false. His purpose was to write a panegyric and not a history, and Sidonius added some spurious names to the list of real participants, for example Burgundians, Syrian Franks, for dramatic effect. Thanks for watching. Don't forget like the video and don't forget to subscribe.